this is Erica with Launching Legacies. Welcome to our daily devotional. Today we're continuing our devotional series on the presence of God, and we're going to start talking about the delight of God's presence. So we're going to go to a scripture that you probably have read many times, and I'm going to read it. This time I'm going to read it in more than one version so that you can see how it changes, but it adds value to the passage. And particularly, we're going to talk about this scripture and what it's implying, right, in context. So we're reading Psalm 16, verse 11, and it's talking about the presence of God. And I'm going to start with the Amplified version, which says, "You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore." And so we see that that in that passage, he's saying, you're going to show me the right path of life. But so now we see what's the delight of your presence is that it's going to be full of joy, right? And then at your right hand, pleasures forevermore, which is, again, being in his presence is being at his right hand. So it's a little bit of redundance, but he's saying, like, look, being with you is full joy, and also it is pleasure forevermore. So now let's read another translation. I want to read the Message, which is actually a paraphrase, and it says, "Now you've got my feet on the life path, all radiant from the rising, from the shining of your face. Ever since you took my hand, I'm on the right way." Okay, and so it doesn't talk about the joy or the pleasures, but he's paraphrasing it. So he's like, basically, I'm on the right path because I'm with you, and your shining face is radiating. So there's your presence, is your face, right, is symbolic there, and so that becomes quite beautiful. Now I'm gonna read a paraphrase called The Voice, and it says, "Instead, you direct me on the path that leads to a beautiful life." Right? "And as I walk with you, the pleasures are never ending, and I know true joy and contentment." Okay. And so I'm going to leave it there that way. The rest of the translations are pretty similar. But what can we gain from these particular translations or paraphrases of this passage is really important. We find that the writer is talking about the path of life, it being synonymous with or intended to be in the presence of God, right? And so what he's saying is that basically we're not really living life, right, unless we're in the presence of God. And then we find that the life that we live in the presence of God is full of joy, and there's pleasures in it. And so there's a delight in the life that God wants us to have. But that life, he always intended, according to this scripture, he always intended that life to be in God's presence. And so then we find that this is not just about the delight that I get joy and I get pleasures, that's really great to add to my regular life. No, the passage is saying, listen, really, I'm not living life until I'm in his presence. And then I find that my life is joyful. Then I find that life has this deeper meaning. And so we find that when we're seeking the presence of God and we're in his presence and really spending time in that presence, and wherever we are or have been in his presence, we're deepening that place. As we deepen our time in the presence of God, we should be deepening our pleasure. We should be deepening our joy. We should be really enjoying more of a life. I remember when I had a job that I didn't like, and it was always very time consuming. It's taking up all this time, and I really didn't care for it. I just thought that kind of like this job is sucking my life, right? And so when I finally transitioned from that job into a job that I truly enjoyed, it was like I got my life back. I was like, oh, this is what life is like. When you actually get the freedom to do what you want to do and you enjoy what you're doing, and then it happened to be a bonus that I was getting paid for this new job that I enjoyed so much better. But it changed my whole perspective. My attitude was better. The way I thought about things were better because I was actually experiencing freedom from this thing that I didn't enjoy. It was just kind of a means to an end, became an actual vocation for me. And when I began my vocation, I was like, oh, this is great. This is enjoyable. And it wasn't as much about the hours that I worked or any of those other details, maybe not even really about my pay, but it was about really having this opportunity to do something that I enjoyed. And so I think about this passage in the same way, is that we can be going through what we call life, right? And just living a regular Christian life, maybe reading the Bible, maybe following God's rules, maybe going to church, and all these things are the things that we talk about at church. But who really talks about the presence of God and how important it is for the life of a person who loves Him? In other words, we haven't really experienced anything until we've experienced His presence. But there are many people, there are many Christians who don't ever recognize or experience the delight of God's presence. Or if they do, it's minimal. They'll have this moment in which I feel stirred because God is there, and then I walk away from that and I go back to live my life, and then I come back into that moment maybe again, maybe I never come back to that moment, and just always say, well, there was one time when I was praising God that I really felt like He was there with me, and I was so grateful for that time, and that's their testimony, and they move on with the rest of their life. But this scripture implies that no, there is a path of life, and on that path of life, the presence of God is integral, meaning God should be there with us. We should be experiencing and delighting in the presence of God always. And so this scripture is very rich to me because if you read it correctly in the context, if you just read many different translations, which I'm going to, which was on the page, was many different translations, and I'll give you the link for all of these like 15, 20 translations that you can read this same passage in. You start to get an understanding that is more than just saying, you'll make my life nice, comma, or semicolon, and in your presence, fullness of joy, and then there's pleasures forevermore also. No, we find that really what he's saying is, my life makes sense because of your presence. I know what joy is because you're here. I experience pleasure because I'm in your presence. And so he's saying, look, there is no life without this presence. There is no joy without this presence. There are no pleasures other than being in your presence. And so that means if the writer is delighting in that, how much more do we need to delight in that? How much more do we need to seek the presence of God? How much more do we need to recognize and know that He wants us to be there with Him? Well, I want to encourage you by discussing this passage and how much we should delight in the presence, that you would find some delight in your time and your presence with the Lord. And now I'm going to say this. I already said it maybe yesterday, but I want to be clear about it today, that when you get into a certain place with the Lord and you think that you have made it to the top of the mountain, keep going. Because there are plateaus in everyone's lives, and we climb and then we plateau, then we climb and then we plateau, and then we climb and then we plateau. But I don't believe that we ever get to the fullness of the top of the mountain with the presence of God. In other words, I believe what the scripture says, that we will know as we are known when that which is perfect has come, which means, when I said that scripture in reverse, but let's say it in the right way, when that which is perfect has come, we shall know even as we are known. Okay, that's how it goes. Same meaning, but I want to be correct on the way I'm saying it. But what that passage is talking about is that, listen, we think we understand and we're aiming at a mystery of who God is, but when Christ returns, we will know and be loved and understand the fullness of His glory, even as we are known and understood, because He's experienced the fullness of His glory towards us is made full. In other words, He knows exactly who we are. He loves us for exactly who we are and what we can contribute. He knows where we fall short. There isn't a question of who we are to God, and from His perspective, it's already said and done. But for us, we will know as we are known. We're going to have that same ability of knowing when we're in His presence. And it's going to be amazing. But why not practice it now? You'll never fully reach the top, I don't believe, like I said, until Christ returns, which gives us something to aim for. But why not aim for another plateau and another plateau and another plateau? Why not keep climbing until we get to the highest place that we can achieve while here on earth? And then we can delight in that higher place once in heaven. In His presence, there is fullness of joy. And at His right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. I tripped over that last part, but I hope you don't. In His presence, there is fullness of joy. God wants us to experience the fullness of joy. You want your kids to experience the fullness of joy. How much more our Father in heaven? And He says, at His right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. We'll always be pleased. We'll always be delighted. if we find ourselves in His presence. We're praying for you that you will find yourself in His presence more and more and more and more and more and delight therein. Please be praying for us as well, because we want to be there, right? We want to be in the presence of God as much as possible. And we will see you again tomorrow with another devotional. Until then, be blessed.